Deprogram Enlightener. Deprogram Enlightener.
Shalom, shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, shalom, shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, you're now under the sounds of the voice of your Ark Tazadaq. And what I'm about to give you is very, very useful information if you actually use it. And to show your appreciation, you know, throw a donation my way, because I could have very well charged you for this type of information. You know, give the video a thumbs up, and share the video with as many people as possible, because the more people that become, you know, actually inform on how this de facto, you know, government, so-called government, because it's a de facto, works, then the more effective you will become. No, as usual, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourselves a competent counsel and then please be advised. What I'm about to give you is through the spirit of Yahweh, and it's to be taken as education and to actually enhance your faith through the spirit of Yahweh. I do nothing of myself. I'm inspired by the Heavenly Father, Yahweh. So what I'm going to teach you is how I, you know, learn to authenticate my birth certificate. Am I telling you to do this? Am I suggesting that you do this? No way. Not at all. I'm just facilitating information that I have, giving you right knowledge. And if you decide that you want to do so, then you do so at your own will. You're in the valley of decision to do so. But I am at no way or in no way telling you to authenticate your birth certificate. I am merely showing you how I do it. So, you know, today, the vast majority of the people are defined as corporate constructs or corporate fiction or straw man or human resources. You know, believe it or not, you're actually essentially owned by a de facto that refers to itself as government. Many of you quite often hear me use that term de facto. Essentially, it means existing in fact, but not officially established. De facto means existing in fact or in effect. It may be in effect, whether by right or not, it's still in effect. Or it's literally meaning that it exists from a fact. So a de facto in English could essentially be applied, you know, to anything that has any sort of substance of something without a former name, so to speak, such as a de facto government, is actually one that actually operates from all the power of the de jure government or the regular government, but without official recognition. So it exists in facts, what you think is government, but it is not even lawfully recognized. You give it validity. So the de facto, if I would say the de facto segregation isn't the result of law, but can be just as real and deep-rooted as legally enforced segregation. So the de facto leader of a group, be it be the president of the corporation of the United States in Washington, D.C., the de facto leader is just one who all the rest seem to follow. It's a de facto leader. So the origin of its word, it has its etymology of de facto, has its etymology in medieval Latin. And literally, from the first fact that we could actually see it being used was approximately around 1601. So, brothers and sisters, with that, you have a de facto. You don't have a lawful government because it's not officially recognized. So, the de facto wants us, you and I, as individuals, to actually be tagged and tracked and controlled. So, if you have not become a secured party creditor, or you are not in a sovereign capacity, then the government owns you, or owns your title that you refer to as a name. So, you are a volunteer slave. You can't be a slave anymore unless you just volunteer to be, or unless you consent according to the 13th Amendment, except if you break the law. Then slavery is legal. So all people that's actually in the penal systems, you are a legal slave. Because you broke the law. And it doesn't matter what you did. You could spit on the sidewalk. Once you break the law, slavery, according to the 13th Amendment, is legal. Do you understand? And under the 14th Amendment, you could actually volunteer to be a slave by being a United States citizen of the federal corporation. So, and you are actually made one at birth by way of your mother or mom being an informant. See, she informed the de facto state that she had new property for the state. She informed on you by way of the live record of birth. So when she signed a live record of birth as the informant, and ignorance of the law is no excuse, because chances are she was not aware of this. 99% of the people that do this are unaware. And the other 1% that do it does so out of fear from CPS. So the hospital is actually funded approximately $500 for every new biological property that they actually turn over to or registered with the de facto state by way of mom's signature on the live record of birth, from which a birth certificate is essentially created on bond paper. And the way out of this is to become a secured party creditor. Now, if you have not become a secured party creditor yet, what are you waiting for? Why are you staying under a de facto jurisdiction? That's the question. So if you want to become a secured party creditor, stop the video right now, email me, and I can show you the principles that tazadaqshah used to become a secured party creditor and a free man, and is no longer under a de facto jurisdiction, no longer an incompetent ward of the state. So if you want to become a secured party creditor, email me at creditors, debtors, contracts at yahoo.com, and I can show you how I became one. And if you choose to do so, then you could actually do so for the required donation. Or you could visit www.creditors, debtors, contracts, and commerce.org and click on the link. And you will be on your journey to become a secured party creditor. But you must do so at your own free will, and you must want to do this. Now, I can show you how I became a secured party creditor, and no longer am I subject to the de facto jurisdiction. However, remember, do not email me unless you are ready to become a secured party creditor. I get far too many emails about people, oh, Tazadaq, can you guide me to become a secured party creditor? You should email me once you're ready to donate for my time, effort, energy, and extensive research on how I effectively became a secured party creditor. If you're not ready to do that, then don't email me. I do not have time for frivolous conversations or back and forth emails that are meaningless. My time is essential, as yours should be. You know, my time is extremely valuable and essential. So, to become a secured party creditor, it only works if you're actually in the right state of mind and you have the devotion and discipline that it requires to carry out the process. Now, many have tried and they've received documents and they sit on the documents for months, and then they want to blame myself or someone else for their own negligence and their lack of commitment and understanding thereof. So you must have faith, first of all. You must have the right state of mind. If you don't have the right state of mind, then you're going to be blocking yourself with your self-negation, with your negative thinking. Because if you, as you think in your heart, so are you. And your mind will be blocking you from becoming the very thing that you actually desire. So if you lack the commitment, the discipline, and desire, then don't waste my time. You must have faith. You must believe that this will work. It all starts with your mindset. Because if you think that it's not going to work, then guess what? It is not going to work. You must have the faith. So the first thing that you must understand is that you must have faith. And all I do, by the grace of Yahweh, is ask you to have faith and believe in the Most High and in yourself that this works. But if you're blocking it with your mind, if you believe it will not work, then it's not going to work for you. It is not for you, and then you can never become a secure party creditor because you are blocking it with your minds. So the scripture reads in the book of Proverbs 3, verse 5, for with Yahweh, nothing is impossible. So you must stop blocking it with your mind. You must relinquish your fears, and you must stop blaming others or me and start looking at yourself as to why you cannot accomplish something. The book of Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse 1, it says, now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. So you must have faith. If you do not have faith, then you won't be able to see yourself becoming a secured party creditor because you are blocking it with your mind. Proverbs 23, verse 7 says, what you think in your mind essentially becomes your reality. I'm paraphrasing it, but the scripture says in Proverbs 23, verse 7, for as he thinketh in his heart, what is your heart? It's your mind. That's the core of your thinking. So is he. So if you think that you won't be successful with this, guess what? You're not going to be successful. So stop blaming me, stop blaming others, and blame yourself. If you get documents and you settle on them, if you get documents and you don't comprehend them, that's your fault. Because I tell everyone, do the work. Do the research. Sit down and read each and every document thoroughly. Make sure you understand this and overstand this. Because if you don't, what do? You keep emailing me, Tazadaq, what does this mean? What does that mean? What does this mean? Did you follow the instructions? When you go to the doctor for medication, and for the medication to be effective, the medication actually has instructions. And to, you know, make this medication work as it should, you have to follow the instructions. The medication may say something, take 4 capsules 4 times daily, every 4 hours. Now, if you go and take the damn stuff every 12 hours, it's not going to work as it should. And if you go and overindulge and take 8 capsules every 2 hours, then you're likely to OD because you did not follow the instructions. It's the same way with this process of becoming a secured party creditor. You must follow instructions. If you do not follow the instructions, it's not going to work for you. It's not for you. You must follow instructions. When you're dealing with law, little words mean a lot. Case in point, Kings County is not the same as the County of Kings. Do you understand? One is the actual county and one is a corporation. The little word of changes the whole meaning thereof. So today, free of charge, I will teach you how I complete the authentication of a birth certificate. So, you know, and again, to show your appreciation, you can shoot a small donation my way for my time and energy. You could give the video a thumbs up and share it with as many people as you possibly can. What am I giving you? Right knowledge. I am not giving you legal advice. I am not telling you to do this. What I am doing is showing you how I do it. So, when I received my authentication from the United States Department of State, my actions did not establish me as sovereign or a secured party creditor. You see, I was born sovereign. I'm indigenous to the land. How do I know that I was born sovereign? Because I know that this system of law was actually taken from the laws of the Torah. And in the book of Genesis 2 and 26, it says, "And Yahweh said, let us make man in our image." Wait, so if I, man, am made in the image of the Creator, then I am the authority over everything on the planet. I am already born sovereign after our likeness. And if I'm made after the likeness of the Creator, then what could be more powerful than I? Man made in the image and likeness of the Creator. And let them have dominion. So I have dominion, meaning authority, over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth. Man, man was given this authority, this sovereignty, by the Creator, Yahweh. So it is not right for any kind of de facto to come along and to try to deprive you or I, man, of that sovereignty, of authority. Sovereignty is authority, and authority is sovereign. Do you understand? So, I have dominion over all the earth and over every creeping thing that is upon the earth. So if I, man, is made in the image and likeness of the Creator, Yahweh, no de facto can take away that from me. Therefore, I reiterate, I was born sovereign. So Yahweh created man in his own image. In the image of Yahweh created he him. Male and female created he them. Wait. So man, I man was created in the image of Yahweh. And then from me, man created he them. So it was the man that was created in the image and likeness of Yahweh. And then from man created he them. Male and female. So, brothers and sisters, this is why I was born with authority. I was born sovereign. Because sovereign is authority. And if the Creator gave I, man, authority over all on the earth, how can a de facto that has labeled itself government come and deprive me of something given to me by my Creator, when the laws of the Creator conflicts with man-made laws? I don't know about you, but I will obey the Most High. I will obey Yahweh. You see, my government is a government of Yahweh that you refer to as God. So, I am without the United States. The United States is a foreign country. I exist outside of that society. I am indigenous to this land. You Moors understand what I'm talking about, Islam. And many of you Hebrews are starting to learn what I'm talking a lot about, Shalom. Because many of you know that many of our people was here long before Columbus ever set feet on the shores of America. Just take a look outside about 28 miles out of Los Lunas, New Mexico. You find the mystery stone written in ancient Hebrew and probably your Hebrew. Why? Because we was already here thousands of years prior to any European ever setting feet on the shores. Yet you're gonna come and deprive the indigenous people of their sovereignty? No way. So get your minds right, folks. So what you have to do is to take back your rights, because you gave them up by consent. They didn't deprive you of them. You gave them up being ignorant, and ignorant does not mean that you're stupid. It just simply means that you do not know. So let me tell you something about the authentication of public documents. Now, since the live record of birth was used to create the birth certificate, as I, you know, formally mentioned, it's important that I point out that since my document is to be used in a foreign country, the United States, which is actually a federal corporation, according to 28 USC 3002 subsection 15A, the United States Corporation, it is necessary to have that particular document authenticated. Now, is this a must to become a secure party creditor? No. So why are you teaching me this, Tazadaq? Because I'm giving you an extra step that you could actually use to set yourself free, according to John 8 and 32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So, an authenticated certificate, it actually, you know, an authenticated certifies the signature and the capacity of the official who actually executed the document. That's one reason we want it done. So the authentication may also be authentication. The authentication may also authenticate the seal of the official. Do you understand? Do you understand? So my certificate of authentication was essentially issued by the Secretary of State to authenticate the public document for use in my country, which is not a member of the 1961 Hague Convention abolishing the requirement of the legalization for the foreign public documents. So my apostille or my certificate of authentication, and to those of you that don't understand what an apostille is, go and define the word, because that's another thing that our people suffer from is aphasia. You don't clearly comprehend the proper usage of words. So my apostille or my certificate of authentication is actually issued by the Secretary of State, usually on one page document that actually contains a blue laser printed facsimile of the Department of State seal. In other words, the Department of State seals it. So both the apostille and the certificate of authentication is actually included on the facsimile signature of the Secretary of State. Or if not by the Secretary of State, is usually done by his or her deputy. So when I had the birth certificate authenticated, I knew that I existed outside of the corporate United States, and that my signature on the document is right hand justified. So my return address, I don't have an address, I have a domicile, but for the sake of this dialogue, I'm going to use the word address so that you can understand. My return address, a domicile, I always put the zip code in brackets, so that I will not invoke federal jurisdiction. And I never use what they refer to as an abbreviation such as NY. I write out the word New York. Brooklyn, New York. I don't write BK, NY. Do you understand? Because again, what you think is an abbreviation actually invokes federal jurisdiction. Do you understand? Do you understand? So, my return address or domicile is always in brackets with no abbreviation. Authenticating my birth certificate was actually only the initial step to becoming a secured party creditor or sovereign. Is it mandatory? No, it's not mandatory that you authenticate your birth certificate. Again, why are you teaching me this, tazadaq? Because to those of you who don't want to do so, I can show you how I did so, but I'm not telling you to do it because I can't offer you legal advice. It's not mandatory. It's just an extra step that one could take. Now, again, I'm not suggesting that any of you do this. I'm just merely a dispatcher of information sent by Yahweh to wake our people up. So, again, if you like this video, give the video a thumbs up and share this video with as many people as possible. Don't hate, participate. Because if you're not part of the solution, then you're part of the problem. So, this is actually an additional step in reversing the implied contracts that you actually consented to. And it would actually help the de facto to no longer own you. You will no longer be its biological property. You will no longer be a chattel slave or human cargo. No longer owned by the de facto, and developing your evidence as a secured party creditor or sovereignty and removing you from the de facto jurisdiction and the de facto state jurisdiction. So, I'm actually giving this to you for free, family. Because the spirit actually essentially moved me to give you these instructions on how to authenticate the birth certificate. So, at my Secretary of State and the U.S. Department of State, then, you know, if after watching this video, I hope and trust that you will become a secured party creditor. And to do so, just simply email me at creditorsdebtorscontracts@yahoo.com. Or again, visit the website www.creditorsdebtorscontractsandcommerce.org and click on the status correction link. So, Tazadaq, how do you authenticate the birth certificate? Well, this is the process for authenticating a birth certificate. But what's the benefits, Tazadaq? Well, essentially, it made me owner of the birth certificate trust. I am pretty much the beneficiary and not a trustee, which is essentially a subject. So who are you? Where do you live? What is your country? These are questions that you need to know. Now, the birth certificate was actually the primary document used to enslave us all that was actually born in hospitals because mom became the informant and she informed on you. She informed the state that she actually had more property for the state. So mother not only granted the de facto state the right to take her children and our children, her children's children, whenever they want to, it was actually registered as a security at the Depository Trust Company, the DCT. And, you know, a little off note, a little side note, to those of you that's actually in prison, that's generally who's holding your CUSIP number, the DCT. And it's actually used by the government to pay the surety of their public debts that neither you or I created. Now, you could think this is funny all you want to, but if you do your proper research, you're going to find out that this is not a damn joke. So you can stop smiling now. So to be specific, the de facto tax the person and name on the document for the profit to pay their public debts, to pay their federal debt. Now, I know no one ever told you this before. Some of you actually may have heard it, but you didn't know how to actually go about the process, but you're going to learn today. So, under the democracy, which many of you so-called blacks just actually learn to love, you know, you've grown to love it. But under a democracy, as long as you keep registering your biological property, meaning your children or your babies and so on and so forth, you and them are subjects or slaves or chattel property. So the property that they call children with the state, they will always have an endless supply of human cargo to tax as long as you continue to register your biological property and mom continues to inform on you. So folks, the major step to actually regain your freedom is to become a secured party creditor. But in doing so, why not authenticate the birth certificate? And to become that secured party creditor, contact me. Man up. So you must regain birth title as opposed to the birth certificate title. Any certificate means up that you've actually given up true title. A certificate is not true title. A true title is something such as the MSO, manufacturer statement of origin, for every car that comes off of the assembly line. A true title is the allodial title to your property, not a certificate of title. Do you understand? The very moment that you have a title to anything or a certificate to anything, such as a marriage certificate, you've given up true title and you've given someone else legal authority over you or your property. Do you understand? Or your marriage. So the information that I'm about to present to you is lawful. It's a process that I use to reclaim the status holder in due course to the title of me. And if you so elect to do so, you can reclaim the title of you, man. So, you know, I've learned that the essential element in the Minnesota court rule 220, remember that term, the Minnesota court rule 220, you know, in all other states, you know, I've examined it, including the state of Oklahoma and so on and so forth, and the laws and natures relating to the birth registration process was pretty much concealed or hidden. But I contend if this rule could actually be used in one state, then I contend it can be used in all of the others. So let us have a look at Minnesota Rule 220, birth certificates. So the registered of titles is authorized to receive for registration of memorials upon any outstanding certificate of title and official birth certificate pertaining to a registered owner name in said certificate of title showing the date of the birth of said registered owner, providing there is attached to said birth certificate an affidavit, listen well folks, an affidavit of an affiant who states that he or she is familiar with the facts recited, stating that the primary name is the said birth certificate, is the party as one of the owner's name in the said certificate of title, and that thereafter the registrar of the title shall treat said registered owner as having attained the age of majority at date of 18 years after the date of birth shown on the said certificate. Tazadaq, that seems to be written in legal terms. Could you break that down? Could you explain? Well, basically, to make it plain, essentially it's saying the birth certificate is a certificate of title. So just like your certificate to your conveyance or your automobile, for so you could understand, or your car, to be frank. So you have the right to use the name, but the state actually has legal title controlling the entrance in the property, which actually happens to be, in this case of the birth certificate, you are the property. You are the human cargo, and the state is actually controlling the interest. So we've been taught in the public school system to associate our names with our physical self, all the way up from pre-K up into where you are today, unless you've actually been taught better, never realizing we're just using the name that the de facto state owns. The name is not you. I am the living soul. The name is not you. That's just a way to get your attention. You're not the name. And as long as you affiliate yourself with the name, this is how they often get jurisdiction over you in their colorable courts. You must understand that and overstand that you are not the name. Tazadaq. Why do you have that title, Tazadaq? Well, I have many. A son calls me dad. And I have many other titles. But I realize I am not that title. I am not that name. But the very moment that you begin to think that you are, then that's when you begin to get in trouble. So just like your automobile, you get to use it because you have what is known as equitable title, but the state has legal title. And therefore, since the state has legal title, You must get it inspected. You must have insurance on it, and you must register it. And you must obey all of the traffic rules and regulations because the state has legal title, which is the most important title. So also Rule 220 implies that the state can treat you as a minor. It can treat you as a minor or an infant, despite your age. So you're deemed an incompetent ward of the state. Incompetent to handle your own affairs because you are a minor. A minor is not competent enough to speak for themselves. So when you go into a court, a colorable court, they appoint someone to speak for you because you are viewed as a minor. That is your status. This is why it is imperative to change one's status. So to break this, you must become a secured party creditor or even sovereign if that is your will. So as an extra to the registrar, you authenticate the birth certificate to inform them via affidavit that you are no longer their legal property and that you are the legal age of majority, competent enough to handle your own affairs. So the state actually holds legal title by mere presumption and assumption. They think all of you are the same. They treat you all the same because they operate off of presumption and assumption. Why? Because you have not revoked power of attorney. You have not claimed that you are the legal age of majority. So your mother informed on you. Then you became property of the state, thereby giving powers to them. And you haven't gotten it back. You've never gotten it back. So how can you get your title back without being disruptive and confrontational to the de facto state? Well, I'll show you. I'll show you. Let's have a look at UCC 9-311 Alpha or A. And UCC 9 essentially deals with securities. So we see that maybe there is a statute that could essentially get us to accuse the original title, or should I say, gain access to the original title without being disruptive or even confrontational with a de facto governor. UCC 9-311, perfection of security interests and property subject to certain statutes, regulations, and treaties. It says in Section A, security interest subject to the law, except as otherwise provided in subsection D, the filing of a financial statement, a lien, is not necessary or effective to perfect a security interest in property subject to 1. A statute, regulation, or treaty of the United States whose requirements for a security interest obtaining priority over the rights of a lien creditor with respect to property pertinent Section 9-310 Alpha. 2. List any statute covering automobiles, trailers, mobile homes, boats, farms, tractors, or the like, which provide for a security interest to be indicated on a certificate of title as a condition or result of perfection, and any non-uniform commercial code, central filing, statute, or 3. A statute of another jurisdiction which provide for a security interest to be indicated on a certificate of title as a condition or result of the security interest obtaining priority over the rights of a lien creditor with respect to the property. Now, knowing thus, I now turn your attention to 28 U.S.C. 1733. 28 U.S.C. Code 1733 states, government records and papers copies. Section B, properly authenticated copies or transcripts of any books, records, papers, or documents of any department of agency of the United States shall be admitted in evidence equally with the original thereof. So, in layman's term, what this means is that if I get my certificate of title properly authenticated, then it is possible that it would actually be treated as equal to the original. Is that correct? Watch this. Now, something you should know about the authentication and certifications. See, authentications are merely used to verify the authenticity of the notary signature and also therein the authenticity of the documents for all states that not all states that have not signed onto the Hague Convention treaty. Do you understand? So the certifications and the apostilles do the same thing for countries that are signatories to the Hague Treaty. So the clerk of court usually will try to settle for a certification or try to get you to settle for a certification instead of an authentication, and they're not the same. I didn't go for it. So they will usually try to get you to settle for a certification instead of an authentication as they did me. So you must make it plain that, hey, I need this properly authenticated. I want a properly authenticated copy. So now, I did not find a list of the states that are not Hague signatories. However, when I went to search online at www.hcch.net/index.en.php and saw the Hague website, I then clicked on the 9-member contracting states on the left side of the menu. And then I proceeded to click on the tiny map at the top of the page and downloaded the map. Now, the countries in gray are the ones I was looking for. So, then I found one that I like and I verified it. So, I verified that it was not on either of the list of countries in both the non-member contracting states and the HCCH member states list, such as Jamaica or Taiwan, or one of those states, countries, should I say. Neither of those are on the list. So I then selected the one that I wanted to select that was not on the list and used the federal form DS-4194. That's federal form DS-4194. So, excuse me, I gave to the clerks who wanted to know the destination. Okay, tazadaq, so what's the process? How do we get to the process? Well, brothers, sisters, the process that I use, I first got a certified copy of the certificate of live birth authenticated at each level of government. Now, it may apply to you that you may need to get it authenticated at the county level as well. If you don't need to get it authenticated at the county level, don't get it authenticated at the county level. Just get it authenticated at the state and federal. But if you need to get it authenticated at the county level, then get it authenticated at the county level. So the first step is to get a certified copy of your certificate of live birth. And this is actually often referred to as the long form. You want the long form. And this is not the same as the uncertified regular birth certificate. I'm not talking about that. See, many of the states had them at the county, but many of them do not. But some of the states will have them at the county where you was born. But some of the states, such as states like Oklahoma, keep them at the vital statistics office. So, if they have it at the vital statistics office and you're close, then you could go there and get yours. I've been there to get mine before. Now, if not, then you could visit the website www.vitalcheck.com. And get the long form from there. And the next step, I then proceeded to get the certified certificate of live birth authenticated at each level of government. Now, initially I got mine at Kings County. Therefore, I got it authenticated by the county superior court clerk. So whatever option that they may have in your area, that is what you want to follow if you're going to do this. And again, I'm not telling you to do this. This is not legal advice. Just telling you how I do it. So, I then took it up to the Secretary of State, who actually handles authentications for my state. Now, in the state of New York, their office is at 123 Williams Street, Site 20. New York, New York, 10038. And basically had them authenticate the certificate or the certified certificate of live birth. And then what they usually do is attach a page on the front with a brass rivet. You know what I'm talking about. And then the third step, I went down to the Department of State of authentication and downloaded the DS form 4194. You do this online on the right hand side and fill it out with 9 hug, and I use the county of my choice. I'm sorry, did I say county? I use the country of my choice. You decide what country you want to use. You use Taiwan, you use Jamaica, you use the country of your choice. Then, my preference was to use prepaid postage for a self-addressed return document mailer, and I enclosed it with my money order, and I completed the DS-4194 and the authenticated certified certificate of live birth in a large envelope. And then I sent that off to the address on their website via certified mail. Now, eventually, you'll receive a properly authenticated certificate of live birth. And it usually will read something as follows: United States of America, Department of State, to whom these presents shall come, greetings. I certify that the document hereunto annexed is under seal of the states of New York, and such seals are entitled to full faith and credit. For the contents of the annexed documents, and the department assumes no responsibility for, certificate is not valid if it is removed or altered in any way whatsoever. I testify, wherefore, I, John F. Kerry, Secretary of State, have hereto caused the seal of the Department of State to be affixed and my name subscribed by the Assistant Authentication Office of the Department at the City of Washington in the District of Columbia, this day of such and such. So, brothers and sisters, I want you to please take note that you want to send an affidavit with your form. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to go over to my slide projector and I'm going to show you the format of an affidavit that I use. Am I telling you to do this? I'm in no way telling you to do this. But I'll show you an affidavit that I use. And if you so elect to do so, then you could do so. All right, brothers and sisters, so basically this is the affidavit that I use. You see it here. I'll stand to the sign side a bit. If you choose to use this, you do so at your own will. Remember, I don't give legal advice. I'm just giving you education on tactics that I actually use. As you see, affidavit of ownership. I'm basically, you know, taking ownership, state of, you know, obviously, New York wouldn't be here if it's not your state. So, state of, whatever your state is, then county, Kings wouldn't be your county if that's not your county. And then, birth certificate. I, Tazadaq Shah Bey, the undersigned of lawful age, being first duly sworn, affirm on oath. I don't swear, I affirm. Dispose and state that I am familiar with the facts recited and the party name in said birth certificate is the same party as one of the owner's name in said certificate of title as we previously went over in the UCC code. Then I simply just sign it. Then I merely take this oath right here to a notary and they sign, stamp, and seal, and that's pretty much it. There's the affidavit of ownership. I'll leave that up a few more minutes. Just keep it there for a few more minutes. Basically, the affidavit of ownership. You may want to go ahead and, you know, write that down. So, you know, that's basically it for the affidavit of ownership. And, you know, we're going to go back over here and I'm going to actually continue on with this presentation and, you know, pretty much bring it to an end here soon. I mean, you know, pretty much it just showed you, you know, the affidavit. So, you know, the combination of a duly authenticated certificate of title and an attached claim is what is known as a counter deed. And from the perspective of trust law, if you understand trust law, I now hold in my hand, after I receive it, the deed back to me. An authenticated certificate of live birth. Now, from the perspective of commercial law, you hold first in line, first in time. That's law. So, first in line, first in time. That's the law. So, you hold the document back to you once you get this done. So, in other words, you are now the real party in entrance and holder in due course to the title of you man or you woman. Tazadaq, where is this necessary? Do I really have to do this? Well, it's good to do if you intend to correct your status and become a secured party creditor. This authentication gets you actually accustomed to navigating through the various levels of this de facto system. Yet, more importantly, in every court case, the issue of status arise. The issue of standing arise. And it usually ends up you not having proper standing because you are the your status is that of a minor. Your status is that of an incompetent ward of the state. Therefore, they get jurisdiction over you. Do you understand? Do you understand? So this actually helps change your status under the legal system that they have actually set up as a trap for you. And have actually made us all wards of the state by consent. Yeah, ignorance. And ignorance doesn't mean you're stupid. Just simply means you do not know. So our status as a ward of the state, you know, puts us under the de facto state jurisdiction. So what's the way out, Tazadaq? Become a secured party creditor or become sovereign. And as I went into the scriptures and showed you at the inception of this educational lecture, I was born sovereign. And if I was born sovereign, you was born sovereign as well. So then why are you now an incompetent ward of the state? It's because you consent. Because you gave consent. Therefore, this authentication process is a major step in correcting your status on the public record. Otherwise, by way of the 14th Amendment, you consent to being a slave. If you accept the benefits of the de facto, you consent to being a slave. Do you understand? And when you're dealing with contract law, you're dealing in commerce, and according to 27 CFR 72-11, all crimes are commercial. So even a crime of murder is dealing with commerce. And if you got to deal with commerce, you got to know contract law. So if you do not want to be a victim, you become a secure party creditor. Don't believe me. Go and check it out for yourself. But if you check it out, contact me and I'll tell you how I accomplish my goals. So to all of the people out there that say that this don't work, that's BS. Don't listen to them. Those are the naysayers. Those are the people that will actually keep you in your condition. And then there are those that has actually tried it and they didn't have the discipline to do the right thing. They didn't have the discipline to follow instructions. So now they want to point the finger. But each time you point the finger, you got three pointing back at you. You didn't have the motivation, and even worse, you did not have the discipline and faith to apply what it required to become a secured party creditor or even sovereign. So don't just go through it. Grow through it. Grow through it, brothers and sisters. So if you're interested in becoming a secured party creditor, contact me now. I just showed you how I, Tazadaq man, authenticate birth certificates or a certificate of live birth, should I say. And if I do it, you can do it. Just have faith. So with that, I'm going to bring this to a close. Again, share this video with as many people as possible. Like the video. If you like the video, it takes 2 seconds or less to click a thumbs up and like the video. So if you don't make a donation for watching this video, I charge you with sharing this video with at least 10 other people. And list under the video the people that you've actually shared it with. So now you know how Tazadaqshah Bay, an aggrieved man, authenticates birth certificates. And if you so elect to do so, you could do so as well. Contact me now at creditors, debtors, contracts, or visit the website www.creditors-debtors-contracts-and-commerce.org. So with that, I'm going to say shalom. I'm going to say Islam to the Moors. I'm going to say peace to the gods. I'm going to say Hotep to the Egyptologists. I'm going to say, you know, black laws to all melanated people throughout America and around the world. Shalom, yasha'Allah.
Deprogram, enlightener.